everybody. So let me start with a quote from the time I used to work at a social network thing. So at one point in time, we decided our BI system did really have quite a lot of trouble, more or less similar as explained in the previous talk. So the daily DEDGE process sometimes took about 25 hours, which is not a good long-term solution. And so we decided to do something about it. And luckily, we got backed up by our founder and then CIO, Lars Hendricks, who founded the company. So pick the best database you need. And we did this. I'm going to explain a little bit more about how we did just that. And of course, as I'm talking here, it's about Exasol. So it was a long title, so I'm going to basically take you on a journey between two companies. First, the social network I used to work with, and now the ticketing company, Eventim. By the way, the picture you see here, it's the Waldbühne in Berlin. It's a very nice open-air location. If you ever have a chance to go to a concert there, it's extremely nice. So I can only encourage you to look at it. So we've seen this picture before. Exa experience last year, quite a large number of people. And when I saw the room and the huge crowd, I thought, well, this company has really come a long way. So I tried to find out how it looked like a couple of years back. I couldn't get a picture, but that's actually the agenda of the first user meeting of Exasol in 2009, which they had four customers, about 15 people in total attending in Nuremberg. So it was quite a little bit smaller compared to this crowd here today. And sometimes on the way, they also changed their company color from red to green. So what I'm going to tell you, first I'm going to a little bit about myself, what I'm doing here, what I did at Xing, what I'm doing at Eventim, and then basically do a little bit comparison, how we used Exasol at Xing, how we do it at Eventim, and what are the differences mainly. So obviously that's me. So at the right side, you see a snapshot from Xing, social network. If you're from Germany, you probably know it. If you don't, then you probably know LinkedIn. It's very similar, so you may want to check this out. So at the right bottom, you see I started as a data warehouse architect at Xing, and my first task was actually to look at the data warehouse setup we had then and see if anything could be done about performance issues we had there. So as a good startup, at this time we had about 100 people. We started with an open source stack using a MySQL database, which worked pretty well until about the size of 2 TB. And when I joined the company, they had already extended this to 3 TB, and it was more or less a nightmare. So we started doing workarounds from the ETL process with an external tool. Then when this external tool didn't work, we built workarounds on top of workarounds. So it really became quite a nightmare. And in the end, 2 people worked full-time on performance tuning. So something had to be done about that. So then how did it all started? So basically, it was quite an accident, so I called it Exasol by accident. So I got a call actually from another vendor sometime in 2008. Don't you want to check out our new MySQL engine? I said, yeah, well, maybe, let's have a look. And then the whole debate within Xing started, let's have a look at the new database. And we decided to do a full-time proof of concept with several databases. So that was the first accident. Second was then we had a little bit look at the market, also at Gartner, and we said, yeah, maybe a columnar database would be interesting, maybe a memory could be nice. And we had about 20 different databases in our long list, started to Google a little bit, and then went, oh, well, there's a columnar and memory database from Germany, from Nuremberg, Exasol. Nobody has ever heard from it before. So we decided to check it out as well. So that's actually a slide from Xing from the POC results. So we actually tested 6 databases, and I don't want to discuss all the details with you. Green is good, red is bad. on the slide, and you see Exasol has a lot of green ones in there, so we were pretty excited about this. The price was a little high compared to nothing with MySQL, so nobody got a green light for price, but it still worked out pretty well. And already during the POC and the time before, we noticed some things about Exasol. They were very committed to our customers, even at the POC. So we had decided to each company would have 1 week to set up the database on our servers, and then we would run test queries, predefined on them. Some of them they knew, some of them they didn't. And Exasol was actually the second database to start the POC. The first one spent about 2 days trying to load our data into the database, even if we have provided some samples beforehand. So that was quite surprising to us and to them as well. Exasol, on the other hand, they already had a look at the data, they wrote a small conversion script, and then were able to load the data within minutes. So that was already a very good start. And as most of you already know, performance is not an issue with Exasol. We saw the same thing. So compared to the old system, we were about 20 to 100 times faster. So that was how basically Xing started to use Exasol. So now I'm going to mix about the two companies a little bit. That's about Eventim. Sean already told you we are doing ticketing. We also do live entertainment in several countries. On the right side, you can see some of our international brands in case you're not familiar with Eventim by that name. We are working in most of Europe, basically, but have also started to go a little bit beyond Europe, so to speak. So we are also active in Russia and Israel and in Brazil. And so at the top right, you see a couple of KPIs. So we do have a quite large number of people. We're doing reasonably well in terms of revenue. And at the bottom, you see our information science department, where I'm from. So what we did is, and I'm going to tell you a little bit more about this later, we did start not as a classical BI department and not in the IT. It's a business unit, so to speak. And one of our general goals right from the start was to create revenue, which is typically quite hard for a BI department. So since most of the revenue comes from selling tickets, we decided how can we support selling tickets? And one thing that obviously came to mind is recommendations, like Amazon does it, like other e-commerce shops do it, but this has not been done for Eventim. And last year, we succeeded in selling about 600,000 additional tickets, which is more than enough to cover our costs. So everybody was happy. My head was sporty, the board of directors was happy. That makes quite a lot of discussions a lot more easy compared to if you only have cost. So this worked nice. So at the moment, we're about 25 people. We're doing everything from CRM to web analytics to classical BI and running the infrastructure. And just as a comparison, for Xing, it was a little bit easier. So their core market is Germany, Austria, and Switzerland. They had a very centralized setup of systems. So it was quite easy to put this into Exasol. At Eventim, we have a lot of not really localized systems, but some systems have already set up for each country. So they are slightly different, and we need to take care of that. So how to start? So Information Science was founded in late 2013, and we already knew a little bit what we're going to do. So we knew we had a lot of information about 60 million customers, lots of transactional data, likes, so to speak, from our internal website, from newsletters. So we wanted to drive innovation within the company, like recommendation, like really starting to work data-driven, with was not happening that much before, and we wanted to create something unique, not just the typical data warehouse, typical BI system. As we were pretty sure we would not grow extremely large in a short amount of time, self-service was a big issue, so we wanted to empower our colleagues from Germany, which is our main market, but also from the other countries, to do as much as possible themselves, so we didn't want them to depend on us. We wanted to have more international cooperation, so we were very Germany-focused at this point. So if a request from another country was put to HQ, it was really hard for them to push this through. So we also wanted to change this, at least in the area where we were supposed to working. So first thing comes to mind, so we started very pragmatic. We wanted to be flexible. So don't start with one fixed plan and then do it, and then maybe 2 years later notice that this might not have been the best plan. So we had some assumptions. First one was relational databases are here to stay. And the second one was that new tools like Hadoop, like Spark, would be very useful to complement the traditional way. So what else did we define from the start? So we wanted on services rather than tools, so pick the best tool for any given service. And of course, don't have too many tools, otherwise it may get a little hard to work on them. So we do prefer buy over build. We had a strong tradition within Eventim, build everything ourselves, which resulted sometimes in this development work taking quite long and also not being as good as maybe an expert doing this for several years, like Exosol, for example. And we wanted to reinforce success. So we decided not to have a proof of concept for each and every tool we wanted to introduce to the company, but only for the ones we didn't have a, say, set champion. So fast prototyping, it's nothing too exciting. And of course, we wanted to use external help by getting started. So tool stack, we didn't do a POC for Exosol because as a new department, we had people from a lot of big e-commerce players in Germany, Zalando, United Internet, Xing, and we decided Exosol was already used by at least three of them, so we were pretty sure it would also be very useful in our case. Kafka was set on and Spark as well for the online stack, and then we did a POC for reporting, which MicroStrategy turned out to be the system of choice, and then also for CRM and for Cloudera, for Hadoop, which is Cloudera. So that's our marketing, internal marketing slide. So what we're going to do, basically, we identified three areas where we wanted to go. So the one in the middle, at the bottom, is the business performance management, classical BI, internal reporting, maybe a little bit of external reporting, both from at an operational level and also up to the board, for example. Then on the right side, also classical CRM for end users, the guys who start to buy tickets from our website. We wanted to send some recommendation also via email, not only on-site. And on the left side, really our partners. Since Eventim is a little bit similar to eBay, so we don't have that many events we organize ourselves, but we sell tickets for everybody else organizing events. So, and these guys organizing events, of course, they want to know, how good are my tickets selling? Do I have enough stock left? Do I maybe have to change the prices if sales does not go too well? So we wanted to give them some kind of tool set to have a better look at their information. So that's the first year, 2014. I was actually the first employee of Information Science. I started January 2014. So we did a lot of stuff in parallel. So on the left side in blue, you see business plan was approved in late 2013, then we started hiring in 2013, and almost by the end of the year, we were complete from the operational point of view, operational team, which is my team, and also the CRM team. At the same time, we did the vendor selection, so Exosol, of course, we didn't do a selection, but reporting tool, we decided in March, CRM 2 months later, and then data mining and Hadoop. Hadoop took a little bit longer because we had a long POC and also we had a long technical discussion and check with our IT if it would be worthwhile to run it on virtual hardware or on physical hardware. In the end, we decided for this one to go to physical hardware. Everything else was done on virtual hardware, which is the standard at Eventim. We also started some international workshops to have a look at our child companies to see what they were doing. Some were pretty advanced in terms of BI, for example, so we learned a lot of good practices from these guys. And of course, then we started the rollout. So putting all the data into Exosol, setting up the CRM system, and building the first reports in MicroStrategy. So that's the infrastructure as it more or less looks now. So before we started, there was basically nothing, or so to speak, we had the UpperVo, which is the web shop, the call center, basically all stuff where you can sell tickets, and at the bottom you have the usual data sources. So I don't want to talk to you about all the details on this slide. So we actually have three main components. First one is Exasol, that's why it's so large in this picture, because almost all data goes through there, at least all the structured data, maybe not all of the web tracking data. Then the next important tool is MicroStrategy, because that's actually our front end. So we have about 250 users using MicroStrategy, and so we can really push awareness, how to use data, what kind of information we have, etc. And the second or the third part is the targeting Evita stuff, so the on the right side. So that's basically our online stack, where we want to push recommendations into the web shop and also online recommendation within emails. So that's actually the part which brings the money, which is nice. And then, of course, you have a lot of systems in between. You have a data mining system, the CRM system, of course. So now, a little bit easier to see. So basically, we have the data sources at the top. Contrary to what I thought when I started at Eventim, they don't have, or we don't have, one ticketing system. So we have about 10. So one big one, a web shop, and then you have a special one for sports clubs, a special one for culture, etc. So, of course, we get data from all of these. Most of the data is not directly from the source systems, but via an intermediate system, because our IT department is very conservative. Nothing is allowed to affect the performance of the web shops or of the ticketing system. So there always has to be an intermediate system, which has their own kind of complexity. Then there's Exasol, of course, and on the left side you see basically all the classical ways what to do with Exasol. So it's the same as thing. So we push information to data mining system, we do CRM, also push the information there, we run ad hoc analysis within the database using SQL, and we're using reports within MicroStrategy. So that's very similar to what we did at Xing. What different is was we're doing at least the pre-calculation for recommendations in Exasol, so like item-to-item matrices from our transactional data, but also some more complex algorithms. Of course, that's not online, that's a batch mode, it's running once per day, and there's an additional online component which then takes care to make the final decision to what to show to the customer. Then we have web tracking data, which goes primarily to Hadoop, but also into Exasol. The original plan was to have only about 2 years of data, web tracking data within Exasol, because of the storage constraints. We still have all of it in there, because it turns out we didn't need that much space. And then we have the one, the middle data feed generator is one tool we recently developed this year. Basically, it's an easy way for us to push information to our partners, because some of them, at least the bigger ones, are very interesting to get a more detailed information how their sales are. Some of them may have their own CRM system, so they want customer data, if permissions allow this, to push to them to make their own CRM. And the other one is our B2B tool, Eventim Analytics. It's basically a web-based tool. It looks a little bit like Tableau, for example. Then you can have an easy interface with data. You can look at performance of your Rolling Stone sales, for example, compared to the Rolling Stone sales from 2 years ago. So it's very easy to interact and don't have to learn anything. Basically, you can just use it. So that's our Exasol setup. We moved to a different system compared to the one we started with. So now we are not running on virtual hardware anymore. We switched to physical hardware. Going to tell you a little bit about this on the next slide. So it's a, I guess it's a pretty similar setup. So we have two data centers. So we need to make sure that an Exasol would also be available in case one of the data centers is turned off. So we actually now running in two systems. Each of them has three nodes and one reserve node. The test or the second system is a little bit smaller in terms of license, so we only have 300 gigabytes of RAM there. And our strategy for failover is basically We do a very regular backup of the live system, push it over to the other data center, to the second system, and in case the first one breaks down, we simply load it into the second system and then turn this on. And that's why the load balancer on top is used to switch between the two. Hasn't happened yet. Hopefully it won't happen that much, but this gives us at least the level of fail-proof we need at the moment. So that's some, for us, very interesting slides. When we changed from virtual hardware to physical hardware, so you see three bars. The first one is from the original virtual setup, which was all normal hard disk, for example. Then we did a test with IT for a new setup on pure SSD, all flash array, which also had a nice impact. And then we switched to physical hardware and saw an even greater impact. So on the left side, you'll see one of our typical ETL processes, which are rather long and have also been the reason for some complaint before, which are now significantly shorter, which is nice. And on the right side, you see some of our reports in MicroStrategy with also some nice performance gains. So what I'm going to show this to you is we were actually quite surprised. So we expected a slight performance increase when we moved to physical hardware, maybe 10 to 30%. And the reason we moved to physical hardware was not performance. It was basically a cost to storage optimization. So we wanted to do a lot of more backups. The new data volume was going to increase. And the amount of storage we would have needed was way too large for the costs we would have needed to pay for a virtual system. So to be honest, so it's already written here, so we did not just move the system to physical hardware, we also added a lot of CPUs, and we had dedicated network. Still quite interesting from our point, because we had long discussions with the IT guys who run the virtual infrastructure. We always had the feeling there may be something limiting the performance of the accelerator system, but we were never quite sure if it's something in our code, is it something in the virtual setup, is it something in the external setup? So we don't know, we couldn't pinpoint it. So at least it's at least a little bit clear, so it has an impact. And to tell you the whole story, when we did the Hadoop test, we also tried this on virtual hardware, and there it was pretty clear that it doesn't make sense because it simply blocks all the infrastructure, so it was performance was very bad. So how we interpret this is that virtual infrastructure is great. We love it for all our other systems. We benefited a lot of times from this when we try to upgrade systems, extended disks, stuff like that. But at some point, if you have distributed systems like Exasol or like an Hadoop cluster, at least in our setup, it doesn't work as good as for smaller systems. So Hadoop, it doesn't work. Small systems does work. Exasol was something in between. But at least it looks like that we will probably continue. Distributed systems will be on physical hardware for the foreseeable future and everything else on virtual hardware. So, and of course, we are very interested in what your experiences are with virtual hardware in general and, of course, with Exasol. So there's two of us here, Stefan and myself. So do talk to us in the breaks. We are very interested to learn more. What are your experiences? So then some numbers from our side. So we do have a moderately big database, I would say. 10 years ago, that this may have been different. But raw object size of about 25 terabyte and mem object size of about slightly less than 10. At the moment, not that big anymore. We do have quite a number of requests per month, and this is actually rather stable because we keep optimizing the system to that we need less SQL statements, so to speak, to do the same amount of work. The number of ETL processes is going up a little bit, and also we're expecting it to grow quite significantly until the end of the year, because we're moving from a batch processing mode to something like multi-batch mode, so not one update for the BI stuff, but something like 6 per day. And we have about 50 power users. And if you look in detail, he is really looking at the Exasol client. It's Exa Plus 5. So that's an example of the front end, MicroStrategy. I told you in the beginning we're aiming for international cooperation, and that's a dashboard the colleagues from Brazil have been working on without any support from us, and I think it looks pretty nice. They can choose which kind of events they want to look at and then see all the KPIs. And of course, the data is completely in Exasol. So what else is there to do? We still have a couple of things left, at least for this year, and then, of course, even more stuff for next year. So main part we're working on at the moment is reduce information latency. So that's the general setup, how we do it. So we have the data sources again, and then the intermediate systems. And you see that some systems are fed up like in real time, some hourly, and some of them even daily. It's probably the same for you guys. So we do import the information about hourly at the moment, but then it stops. So the consolidation and preparing the information for our front-end tools like MicroStrategy is only done daily, because it simply took too long before we made the hardware upgrade. And that's going to change. So some of the source systems are going to do stuff to make it easier to pull the data. And we want to switch for the data exchange in general to 15 to 30 minute interviews, and also do hopefully most of the other stuff at least hourly. That's one part of the strategy, but it's not enough. We have a number of use cases which really requires real-time transactional data. And what we're going to do, we're also going to use Kafka as a message bus to push information outside of the classical ETL to a separate database. Hopefully this will be Exasol, so we'll try out Exasol 6 in the process of the first tests. And then again, for example, in MicroStrategy, have connections to both databases. If it's two, if it's only one, then even better, makes the process more easy. But that's a big step for the end of the fourth quarter this year. And once you have this running, of course, this real-time bus can also be used for other applications, like this B2B application, event analytics, and also for CRM. So that will be a big step for us in general. What else is there to do? So, of course, like any good data warehouse, Exasol wants to get more data, so we're going to introduce a couple of new data sources. So we have about 5 ticketing systems left, which in our case are the high volume data sources, and then about 10 other competitive small data sources also. So then we're going to complete the international rollout for Exasol. So our general strategy is build a prototype for Germany, check it, repair it if something is broken, and then start to roll it out to different countries. Some countries may start with CRM because they don't have a CRM system. Some countries may start with reporting, with BI. It all depends on the level of maturity our countries have. And then there's a big topic of compliance, has already been touched in the morning. So the GDPR directive, which takes effect in May next year, is a big project for the whole company at the moment for us. We are probably in a more easy solution compared to the other ones, because since we have one big data store, Exasol, it's relatively easy to do changes in terms of compliance in one model compared when you have 20 different systems talking to each other. But still, we expect the next 6 months to be quite interesting. And we also are very interesting to talk to you guys about what you are doing, if you are based in Europe, if you are selling in Europe, if you have any more clever solutions than the ones we thought about at the moment. So, after all this is done, we're going to relax briefly around Christmas, and then probably do some more exciting projects next year. Thank you.